It's been a year full of excitement in the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge Series, and the season ends today at Lime Rock Park. It's been a dominant run for the Rum Bum Racing Porsche of Nick Longhi and Matt Plum. With three wins and top fives in 8 of 10 races, they've been the class of the field and will be crowned champions today. But the final win of the year is up for grabs in this grand sports race. Door-to-door, nonstop action is up next on Fox Sports. Fox Sports and the Grand Am Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge welcome you to Lime Rock Park. It's the final round of the 2013 season. It's championship weekend at Lime Rock. It is a cool and cloudy morning here in Lime Rock Park. Welcome everyone. I'm Brian Till along with Calvin Fish and Dorsey Schrader. We'll be bringing you all the stories from up top. Chris Devil, Darren Law working hard in pit lane today. Championship weekend, and for the Rum Bum Racing Team, things look good, but hey, it's the final round. Everybody wants to go out with bragging rights. Matt Plum, Nick Longhi have been the class of the field all year long. Matt Bell, John Edwards, they've had a good season, but they've had some lows, and that has kept them out of the championship hunt. You'll look through the rest of it. The points, yeah, 34-point lead for Matt Plum and Nick Longhi, but the three burning questions that remain today, guys, Calvin, will Multimatic get a win with Aston Martin?
Well, the Aston Martin has certainly been very fast this year, Brian. 7 poles on the year, 6 of them from the Multimatic group. Jade Buford having a record-setting season. But the question is, can they get that first victory? We also understand that Multimatic may be switching to a different brand for next year, so it would be great swan song for that team.
And will Roush rebound and bookend the year with a win? Well, Billy Johnson, Jack Roush Jr. won at Daytona. The beginning of this year looked like a very good season for him. It wasn't. It's been very lackluster. They are yet to win again. They're qualified 5th here today, and it's their last attempt, last try.
Well, and the last question as you look at the starting grid in the strip at the top of the screen, youngest pole sitter in history, Trent Hindman. Here, we all like to talk a lot about the Continental Tire Challenge Series being a showcase for future stars, and Hindman certainly is one of those. The second youngest winner in history, the youngest pole sitter. Well, we'll find out. Chris Neville's down in pit lane with a team that we will be sure to talk about plenty today.
Brian, you said class of the field, really a spectacular season for Rum Bum Racing. 3 wins, their worst finish just 1 race ago with a mechanical problem at Mazda Raceway Laguna Park. Laguna Seca, and you guys have just had an awesome season. You got to do 30 minutes today, then the championship is yours. After that 30 minutes, do you go for the win?
I don't know, but it's definitely going to be the longest 30 minutes of my life. We're just so grateful to be in the position that we're in, and after my 30 minutes is done, I'd love to get the call to go for it, but we're happy to be where we are. Whatever happens, happens. I'm just so proud of these guys.
Well, this championship might be in the books, but Darren, we've still got a race ahead of us.
Yes, we do. And Trent Hindman has only run a couple races this year. He's had really limited run in these types of cars, and he's shown a lot of promise. And this year, or yesterday, he backed it up with pole, which is not an easy thing to do. This is a very competitive class. It'll be interesting to see how he does. He's a Formula Ford champion from last year, so coming from Formula cars into these cars is a big transition, but it's really promising in how well he ran yesterday. So we'll have to see how he goes for the rest of the race.
And you talk about going from a little formula car, an open wheel car, to one of these big grand sports sedans. It is a huge, huge trip. Talk about a huge trip, Dorsey. We'll start in space and we'll use some Google Earth and look down on Lime Rock Park.
Lime Rock Park, one of my favorite, is the busiest road racing track there's ever been built. You see Boston, Hartford down here in New York. Well, what this is, 1.53-mile road race course. It's all right-hand corners except for one. Extremely high speed. The left-hander is the slowest corner on the track. Sometimes we run a chicane back there in turn 5-5A. We will not. We will fly the hill today, one of my favorite things to do. This is a very, very tight racetrack, hard to pass on guys, high speed, a lot of argy-bargy.
And a lot of times you see the names of the turns up on the map. We refer to them by name at this racetrack. There's so few corners, and there are some famous ones. The uphill, you talked about it, flying that uphill as you see the cars right now on the pace laps. One of the most exciting areas of the racetrack.
you'll get up there and stick the car to the ground, and you'll fly over that hill. As you come up there full throttle, it'll lift the front wheels completely off the ground. It'll spin up the rear wheels. You have to make sure your steering wheel's straight, or it'll turn the car at the top of that hill.
Hey, let's go.
These GS cars, Brian, and they have a lot of horsepower. So it's been a pretty cool morning here at Lime Rock Park, so they've got to be aware of that. We saw some spins in an earlier qualifying session just about 30 minutes ago, but the sun is out. It looks like a beautiful day for racing.
Yeah, as those clouds move away, it should be good. We've got some onboards. The 45, you were just riding with Hugh Plum. He'll share that with Al Carter today. And then the 78, the GS Mustang, Richard Gallinello and David Levine. A little further back in the pack. So we've got a BMW and a Mustang showing you some great shots. We talk about being cool and cloudy this morning. Chris, do a little weather report for us.
Yeah, I'll do a little weather report for you there, Brian. And these clouds just starting to dissipate right now. It's about 50 degrees out here. I just checked the track temp, 55 degrees.
Wow.
So as the sun comes through, we should see temperatures in the 70s today. So over the next 2 hours, I'm anticipating this track temperature probably going from 55 to closer to the 90s or so. So going to be very interesting to see how these cars react.
And we talk about track temperature. It's absolutely critical to getting tire temperature, Dorsey.
It is. I mean, these first laps are going to be very tenuous for these guys. We'll have to watch themselves. Racetrack slippery. That's all like a fog. So it's very damp out there.
And one thing they can do, they can certainly, you see guys weaving around, that really doesn't generate much tire temperature,
no.
Believe it or not. That will clean the tires off if you've been under caution and just picked up some rubber on those. But the main thing you can do is really work the brake pedal, try and generate heat through the brake system, which will come up through the wheel and into the tires. So when you get the green flag, you do have a bit of tire temp to work with.
There's our Continental Tire race analysis, 2.5 hours. We talked about the racetrack, 21 Grand Sports cars, and this weekend at Lime Rock, because of the length of the racetrack, we've split the field. Grand Sport runs separately from Street Tuner, and that's going to have an effect on the way these guys race.
Well, and also in the strategy too, Brian, because typically they bank on yellows and they may call some flies in terms of pitting earlier, thinking they're going to get a yellow flag and save some fuel. Without the ST cars out there, I don't anticipate a lot of yellow flags here today, Dorsey.
No, it's going to have to be a big crash to do it. Like you say, Calvin, you won't see it. You can't play the strategy like you're going to have those cautions.
You can see the clouds starting to clear as you look at the manufacturer standings. It's not just about the drivers and teams. Remember, manufacturers have a tremendous amount at stake. And with Rum Bum Racing running so well, Porsche, pretty commanding lead in the manufacturer standings.
Well, they've essentially clinched it, but there's still a fierce battle going on there between Chevrolet and BMW for the runner-up spot.
Well, and we talk about that, bragging rights for the manufacturers, the teams, and the drivers. The lights off on the BMW pace car as the field comes down. Trent Hinman in the BMW on the pole, the 48, the Aston Martin alongside Tonis Kazimitz. He's one tough customer as they look for green down the front. Straight away it waves, and we're racing at Lime Rock Park.
And they break rank early. Look at that TRG Aston. He's out to the outside looking for a way through.
Down into turn one. Cold brakes, cold tires. Who's going to push a little bit further? Who can keep the car underneath them? And you see the Rum Bum Porsche, Hugh Plum. Hugh Plum in the BMW back there.
Archie Bargy there up front. Look at the battle for the lead. Tonis Kazimitz goes to the front. He ran the cushion around turn one and gets the lead into turn three.
And Nick Longhi in that Rum Bum Porsche there, about fifth in the order.
Got by in front of Jack Roush Jr. and the first of those Mustangs climbed the curb down there in Big Bend, loosened the Mustang up, and we have some Archie Bargy and people off track in the back.
Remember, 30 minutes is the number that the Rum Bum team needs to meet, and then the championship should be theirs on board the 78, Richard Gallinello.
See Ashley McCallmont right in front of him, trying to go into West Bend, trying to get that position. There's our championship leader. For them, all they need to do is to get 30 minutes on the board, and they will clinch both the team and the driver's championship here today.
Nick Longhi wants to find a place that he can run comfortably. Where would you want to be? Right now, he's kind of in the middle of a war.
Talk about the war. Look at the war right behind between Big Detroit Iron. It's the Mustang from Roush Racing alongside the Camaro from Stevenson Motorsports.
Yeah, John Edwards there qualified down in the seventh spot. Didn't have the best qualifying run, but they always seem to be a factor here at Lime Rock Park.
Jack Roush Jr. in the red 61 Mustang, and then right behind him, the 51, Joey Atterbury, his teammate. So for John Edwards,
he's been able to get in front of the two Mustangs, and now he has his sights set on Nick Longhi and the Porsche right in front.
Joey Atterbury also moved up a couple positions to get up behind Jack Roush Jr. right there. He was a couple cars back, so a shuffle.
Hugh Plum having a good run here. He's the third car in line, the golden black BMW there, just going through the screen, the number 45. This could be his last race together with Alcada. They're probably going to go in separate directions for next year. Now we're on board with the 45 as Hinman looks to the inside on Tunis Kazimets. Runs the curb. He's got the inside line. Tunis will try to run the cushion. Can't make it stick. Hinman to the front.
Ah, good stuff. And then you see on board the 45 right behind. Hugh Plum now putting pressure on the Aston Martin of Tunis Kazimets.
Tunis was really smart right there, because once he realized he was going to get past, he let it happen and he tucked back in. So he didn't drag everybody along with him and go back even more positions.
Plum's looking for a way by as well, Brian. He's starting to put the pressure on 35. Quick spin there.
Calvert back underway. We understand that the number 7.
Yeah, we saw that, Brian. Remember the TRG, the Aston Martin, Damien Faulkner. He did break line a little bit earlier. You're allowed to go, but you got to wait for that green flag.
Cannot improve your position before the start line. And Damien Faulkner and the TRG Aston Martin did so as ruled by the officials, and a drive-through penalty. But now Trent Hinman had dropped back at the start into second place, but he's taken the point back and is running in front of Tunis Kazimets. Not at all uncommon to see those white Aston Martins running out front. They've been fast all year long, Calvin. They just not have had the good luck. They've not had the reliability to win a race yet.
Yeah, they just haven't been able to close the deal. I mean, speed has not been a problem, but they say we can run a lap by ourselves to speed, but when we get in race conditions, we don't seem to have the total package. But they've been knocking on the door. This is round 11 of 11. That's going to happen. It needs to happen today.
Another team that has run strong all year long is the number 9, John Edwards, right now behind the wheel of the Stevenson Motorsports Camaro. Chris?
And Brian, you were saying that this team is always so strong here. I talked to Mike Johnson, the team manager, about that earlier in the weekend, and he said, you know, actually, before this place was repaved, we were stronger when it was a really bumpy track. But since the repave, we don't feel like we have the advantage that we used to. But we still do have strength there, and he thinks that is just because they set the car up so asymmetrically. Since there's so many right-hand corners here, they really just set that Camaro up to turn right and give up that one left-hander that they're getting ready to head into right now. But it's obviously a very special technique to try and figure that out. And Dorsey, you know, you kind of have that all figured out.
That, you know, that's one thing that most of these guys do with one left-hander, and understand that that left-hander is the slowest corner on the racetrack. It is also a compromised corner where you wouldn't want to go fast through it because the next corner is much more important. So you set the car up to turn right, you set it up to be biased, if you will, and you'll get better lap times around here.
Yeah, it's almost a throwaway corner. You see Hugh Plum now starting to put the pressure on Kazimets. He wants that second spot in a bad way.
We've got a long way to go from Lime Rock Park. The Grand Sport season finale underway. Bragging rights and a champion will be crowned. We'll be back to more. The Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge from Lime Rock. Taking a look out the back of the 78, Richard Gullinello, as he runs back in the 17th position. But this has been the best battle on the racetrack. John Edwards in the red, blue and yellow number 9, the Camaro, really putting pressure on the white 55 Aston Martin of Jade Buford.
Yeah, they've been running side by side for a couple of laps here, and John is looking for a way by. I mean, that Camaro has a lot of grip here in the early going. He's really able to tuck that car and get the grip he's needed, but getting a pass made here at Lime Rock, it is tough, Dorsey. It's really a chess match.
It's a momentum track, and what happens when you catch the back of another car is you lose your momentum. So what he needs to do is back away and get a run and try to time that run to catch right at the downhill, but not to go inside of the downhill, just to catch and get the draft down that front straight.
Well, while this battle continues, Trent Hinman continues to lead for 13 laps now. He's been out in front, and for the Fall Line Motorsports crew, Darren Law, it's got to be good news. Things are looking good.
Well, Charles Espenlob, you've been in this business a long time and seen a lot of guys come up through the ranks. Charles, your teammate's done a great job. I mean, qualifying on pole, very limited time in these cars, and you've personally been working with him as a coach. What's your opinion of how he's doing? I mean, he's on pole and leading this thing.
Yeah, you know, Darren, Trent's doing a great job. Obviously, been in this business a long time. He's 18. I think we've probably been in it a little longer than that. But, no, he's doing a fantastic job. Fall Line did a great job. been working with him mostly. I mean, his driving's been right there as he stepped out of open wheel stuff. It's just getting him used to the heavier car and the weight management of the sedan, and he's picked up on it. He's a smart kid, running obviously a great pace. You know, we let him finish a couple races there, so he's getting there, and there's some finishing drivers out there now. He's leading, and you know, hopefully we'll do our normal fast fall line pit stops and see what we can do at the end.
All right, guys, this is a young kid to definitely watch.
Oh, indeed. I mean, he's impressive. He qualified second before. He qualified on the pole today, and you look at him, he's had great runs. They had a good finish taken away for some avoidable contact at one of the events, but ran seventh at Elkhart Lake, qualified second at Kansas, as I was saying, and just impressive stuff. There's a look at the 71, another one of the Aston Martins. Tony Skazmitz.
This is the championship, Brian. If you can come in and make a statement like Trent Hinman has done this year, Dorsey, you are competing against some of the best road racers on the planet. I mean, there's some really, really strong race car drivers in this series. We're looking at that championship leading car. We still see smoke there, Dorsey. That has to be a concern for this championship leading team.
I tell you, you're not kidding. Trent Hinman is 18 years old. That's the other thing. It's a statement. You know, he's a young guy. But for the championship team, watch this car. Yesterday it was blowing black smoke, and you can see above the tailpipes on the rear balance that there's a big stain already from all of the residual.
There it is.
There's they the need smoke. Another 13 minutes, boys. They've got to get to the 30-minute mark. If they don't make 30 minutes and should retire, then that would leave the door open for John Edwards, Matt Bell. If they can win, they would pop them for the championship. So what's going on, Chris?
Well, I'm sitting down here with Joe Vardy, who calls the shots for the Rum Bump team. And Joe, we've been watching your car on the racetrack last few laps. You got a little bit of smoke coming out of the 13. What's going on?
We don't know. It might be just a little over full. We changed oil in it right before the race. So we might just have a half a quart too much oil in it.
Does that have anything to do with temperature this morning, or do you just burn that off?
No, I don't think it's got anything to do with that. I think it'll be fine.
All right, he's feeling pretty confident down here, but we're definitely going to keep an eye on that. We got about 13 minutes before we can crown a champion, guys.
Joe knows this car only needs to go 30 minutes, so he would have played it pretty safe. He's probably got it full rich, so it can't possibly hurt itself. He might have too much oil in it, which he just said it could have too much oil in it, to make sure that if it burns any oil or whatever, which it is doing, it would have plenty.
Remember, this is a team, Dorsey, that has won this race the last 2 years. Last year, they won the race. Everyone thought they'd won the championship. They won the team championship, but on a technicality, they listed Matt Plum in two different race cars, and you can't do that without starting one of them. They basically had a backup car here in case of an emergency, didn't take him off that entry list for that car, and that cost them the championship. We finished the race last year, Brian,
thinking
that they'd won the championship, and ironically, they didn't.
But let me say this about oil. If you overfill it, you get the smoke because you're passing oil past the rings. It's burning that oil, right?
It usually dumps over, yeah.
But this smoke is getting worse. If you're burning the oil away, well, the smoke's going to go away. But in my mind, the smoke has gotten worse.
There's a third variable that we didn't talk about. And the third variable is that Joe is lying and he's very concerned.
He's a cool cousin.
No, that would never happen. But look at this battle. Jack Roush Jr. in the 61. The first of the two red Mustangs under pressure from his teammate, Joey Atterbury. And how wise is it to pass the boss?
Well, you know, I don't think now with the year they've had, nobody cares. I think it's just every man for himself.
I'll tell you what, that 51 car has been really impressive with Joey Atterbury and Shelby Blackstock. They've done a tremendous job, led a lot of laps this year, and they've been knocking on the door. So I think this group will try and get their act together over the offseason. Realize we've had a lot of speed here, but the championship just seems to get away from us. So we need to analyze what's going wrong here and come back stronger for next year. A lot of good people there and some really strong drivers.
Roush runs his multi-car teams. He doesn't have any favoritism to which one of them wins as long as one of them does. And he doesn't have any team orders, so to speak, except for don't take one another out.
Yeah.
You know, you don't hit each other, but the way things have gone for this team right now, I think they're probably in a research development mode.
The irony is we've always said they keen to give the game away at Daytona. They've always had problems in the opening round of the championship, which has cost them. This year they won the opening round, so we said, here they go. They're going to want a championship charge, and that's never materialized.
And you talk about Shelby Blackstock in the 51. What a great year he's had. He's led on four different occasions. Hugh Plum working hard in this B positive fall line BMW. We'll be back to more Grand Sport action of the Continental Tire Sports Car Championship on Championship Weekend. Just over 2 hours to go in the final round of the 2013 season for the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. You look at Joe Vardy, who calls the shots there at Rum Bum Racing. They need 30 minutes in the books, and the championship can be theirs. Nick Longhi running in eighth right now. That smoke continuing out the back of the Porsche.
Joe's counting backwards from 4 minutes, which is what he needs.
It's worse.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely, it's not good. He only needs 4 minutes. It's four laps, though.
It's what we said. I mean, if you're burning oil off, you burn it off, and then it's gone.
Yeah, there's
this smoke's getting worse.
That's not an overfill situation at this point, I wouldn't think.
Yeah, as Matt Plum said, this will be the longest 30 minutes of his life, and it's probably turned out to be that when he's looking at the visuals here, watching his car smoking pretty badly here in the beginning of this race.
While they have dominated on the season, it's been Trent Hinman who's dominated on the day, the youngster leading 24 laps so far of the 28 that are in the book. So impressive stuff by the youngster at Fall Line Motorsports.
The Rumbum Porsche was yesterday was really, really rich, running black smoke, but this has got blue to it as well.
Kazimitz is closing in on our leader, Garcia.
Yeah,
those Astons are getting a little bit closer. That seems to have a very strong long run pace here. Both Buford, who currently sits in third, that's the second of the white Aston Martins we're looking at on screen. The 71 car right there is Tony's Kazimitz, who started on the front row. So the balance seems to be staying with those Astons, Chris.
Yeah, Cal, I mean, we've seen these Astons go so quick all year long, but it's been some mechanical issues, some mistakes in pit lane that have really kept them out of victory lane. So that team hoping that they can get a win with that car before they change over to a new car next year. You said earlier that they were going to be doing that, and it sounds like they're going to be moving to the next generation Mustang. Larry Holt from Multimatic saying that they want to develop that car as a catalog car so racers can just go purchase it right out of the catalog and take it to the racetrack, much like they did with the last generation Mustang. But we probably won't see that on the racetrack and probably till August or so of next year.
I'll tell you what, Tony's Kazimitz, it was a second and a half at the line 2 laps ago, then it was 0.7 seconds, now it's 0.5 seconds. So Kazimitz beginning to close in, and actually I think Hinman's backing up a little bit because Kazimitz, Buford, John Edwards are all closing the distance down on Hinman, and traffic isn't going to help.
And one thing they got to be conscious of here as well is the fact the fuel strategy, things like that, when you're not getting the yellow, it's hard to save fuel. But see a car off there to the outside, that might have been the 38 car.
That looked like it.
Jim Norman may be having a problem there. That's a car that's been very quick this year, coming off a win at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. He and Spencer Pompelli.
And you see right now Trent Hinman having to deal with traffic.
This could be big.
Oh, it could be huge.
Kazimitz will get a run on here, but they both got to clear that car down into the downhill.
Trying to work their way past the 99. Steve Phillips sharing that car this weekend with Rob Eklund, and all three of the top three get past him, but that allowed Kazimitz to close up even more from 0.5 seconds to 0.3 seconds.
And Hinman's getting a little bit wide there, Brian. Hinman definitely losing a little bit of grip there through Big Ben, Dorsey.
I think possibly the tire's starting to run off on the BMW more so than are on the Aston. Certainly they have the grip level in the infield.
John Edwards now working his way past Phillips in that red and blue Camaro, but there's the car who is looking, and look at Matt Plum looking at the time on the top of the top. Matt Plum going,
let's fog their mirror.
Oh yeah, I mean, talk about elation into despair last year when they ran afoul of the rules with the paperwork.
And there's a rule that's in place now, Brian. If the car does 30 minutes and the second driver gets in, if there's any kind of a problem in an emergency situation, a crash or a mechanical, both drivers will score points here today. So right now, they've got it. They've just passed 2 hours to go. You're a champion, buddy.
I think Matt Plum gagging just a little bit there. So, yeah, he wants to see it over with. But what he really wants to see is his opportunity to get in the car, that blue smoke to go away. And now they can go race. They can go race for fun.
Yeah, exactly. And we'll see now if there's any problem with the engine or not, because what they'll do is take the gloves off.
Yep.
And they'll go for a win now. They'll go full on.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see if Nick Longhi's pace picks up a little bit. Here we see the leaders dealing with traffic right here. Crew has got the word. They are the champs. Great job, guys. Yep. Brilliant season. 3 wins, 6 podium finishes. Looking for another one here today. Look at this. This is for the lead. Kazimitz to the inside.
And right in front, Richard Gullinello in his Mustang.
West Bend, it's a tough pass right there.
Yeah, and a great move. Now Gullinello is in their sights as Kazimitz is going to work on the Mustang as they come down there, the copy Mustang.
Comes the other Aston up the inside.
Here comes Edwards, too. That traffic has really had a huge effect here over the last couple of laps. Top four cars all covered by a blanket.
Look at John Edwards in the Camaro now right there on the rear bumper of Jade Buford.
Stack up there. There's a stack up there. There's contact there, I think, between Buford and Edwards. Is that 78 car was off in the marbles a little bit.
Got too wide and couldn't get the car turned back. You heard the tire squeal. Stacked everybody up. Look at the steering wheel back behind.
Look at this. Colinello's just trying to get out of the way right now. He's like, let me out of this.
I want to disappear, but I can't.
Now it's calmer.
Good stuff. Good stuff. And Tony's Kazemet.
Great run by Edwards there through the uphill.
Pop to the inside here. Might be able to get it done. Nope. Thinks better of it.
West Bend, that right-hander, so quick. Hard to get it in there. You've got to really have an advantage over the other competitor. Now, can John Edwards get a run on Jaden Buford in the white 55 Aston Martin down the front straight?
Hinman's definitely having a little bit of a handling issue right now, Dorsey. He may have run the tires off a little bit by the pace he was running. Here comes Buford to the inside, down into the brake zone. We know the Aston is really strong there. Doesn't have the position. Can't quite make it stick.
But if he can squeak in here, he could squeak in here.
Tuck it in there, yeah, because Hinman was having trouble there with grip before.
What can Edwards do while these two battle? Which direction is he going
to
go?
Look at that. The door was open. John tries to get it in there, but he's going to be on the wrong side for the next right-hander.
And gives it up. He knows it's not going to work.
Now, on to no-name straight, which, Dorsey, as you were saying last night at dinner, is not straight at all. And then into the uphill, Edwards putting pressure on Buford. Buford pressing the BMW in front.
The other thing is Mike Johns will have been on the radio to John Edwards saying the championship is over, go for the win now. He was certainly looking at the big picture. There was an outside chance if the rum bump car had problems and the 9 car took the victory today, they could sneak the championship right now. Just go for it, nothing to lose.
Buford peeks inside at the downhill. That's going to allow Edwards to get a run down the front straight away. Hinman just a little bit defensive to driver's right. Edwards swings wide around the outside in his Camaro.
Might pop underneath here if he can get side by side again. Problem with that is he's got Edwards behind him. He's going to trap him if he does that.
This is what Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge is about. Three different marks right there. Oh, and Buford nice a bit
slide.
Loose.
Nice slide.
Hinman's doing a great job. He really cut his teeth here at Lime Rock Park, was based up here and did his early years with the Skip Barber organization here at Lime Rock Park, so he knows this place like the back of his hand. And he's certainly doing a tremendous job right now holding down that second position.
I agree with you, though. I think the BMW's off its tire game a little bit more than the Astons. They seem to have been able to weather the storm a bit more.
Oh, looks to the inside. That will cost him some momentum here. Buford will have a run.
Definitely. Right here is a perfect way to set a guy up, too.
And they're going
to
catch Preston Calvert in the downhill. Is Hinman going to try to squeeze past? He does.
Watch Edwards. He could get a run on all of these guys.
Absolutely could do it from third place back.
And that was Preston Calvert in the 35 Mustang, his very first ever Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge race. They worked past him successfully, but Edwards swings wide around the outside. He gets Buford, or does he?
No.
Well, he's got to just try and hang in there. If he can try and tuck to the inside, he'll have the inside line for the next left-hander. This is what he's been working on for about half an hour here.
Now
he finally may make it stick.
Yep, now he's got him.
Buford drops in behind, gives John Edwards a little rub through the left-hander. Now Edwards in the number 9 Camaro has his sights set on the 48 BMW in front of Hinman.
You got to look so far in front of where you're racing at. You got to look past the guy you're trying to pass and see what's going to happen to him, because you use those traffic opportunities as a pick, and you want to do it. You want to set these places up. There's only a couple places to pass.
This little battle here really epitomizes what Lime Rock Park is all about and the type of racing you have here. You can go side by side, but it doesn't mean you're going to make the pass. You just got to keep working it. And finally, as we saw, John Edwards got that position.
We talk a lot about the future of sports car racing. You see it right there. Trent Hinman, Jade Buford, John Edwards, some young guns. And if we added up their age, it probably wouldn't total up to Dorsey's.
No.
Look at this.
Edwards to the inside, went to the outside, tucked it back under. Stevenson Camaro up to the second spot.
Trent Hinman just got schooled.
He faked him. Yeah, he did a really good job, too, on that. He faked him up the inside and went out wide and tucked back underneath.
Yeah,
he set that up, like you said, Calvin. He's been thinking about that now for a half hour.
Yeah, that was beautiful. Watch this. He flicks to the inside. Hinman's on the inside. He's not going to break quite as late. Then he gets a little bit wide there.
This
right
is where
at
it's
apex.
Tenuous right here. Yep. You can clip a guy so easy right there that move.
And this is where he's really been struggling for grip. Through Big Bend, finishing off that corner, Dorsey, is where the 46 car's been struggling.
Yep.
So John Edwards teaching a lesson to the youngster Trent Hinman. Edwards now elevated to second, but it's Tony's Kazemet and his Aston Martin that leads in the final round of the 2013 season from Lime Rock Park. We'll be back to more right after this. Season finale at Lime Rock Park, but there's the covered bridge, the Cornwall Bridge, just down the road from Lime Rock Park here in northwest corner of Connecticut. Absolutely beautiful this time of year. Gorgeous scenery around here and an awesome racetrack. What a place to crown a champion and to end the season. There's the 71, the white Aston Martin.
Look at this, though.
Denise Kazmetz, but right behind him, Kazmetz has something he hasn't had all day long. That is a mirror full of that blue, red, and yellow number 9 Camaro. John Edwards behind the wheel, and he's going for the lead right now.
Tucks it to the inside. Kazmetz doesn't defend the line there. It's going to give John the entry down into turn one, so a change for the lead here. Boy, oh boy, that Camaro has been hooked up all day long. John was very patient in getting through those initial positions, and now he's taking it to the front.
Wow, that just looked easy. Too easy.
Looking at tire degradation now this late into the run, I think you're starting to see the difference as cars fall off.
Kazmetz just being really smart here, trying not to fight out too much right now. Still got a little bit to go on this stint, probably about another 15 minutes or so. So we've got to keep those tires underneath them. But John Edwards showing a lot of pace here.
Well, while you talk about Kazmetz perhaps having some tire degradation in his Aston Martin, Damian Faulkner, who got the penalty for a jump start in his Aston Martin from TRG, already up to 11th, having a great run, Darren.
Kevin Buckler, you have had an association with Porsche and been in this business a long time. You've actually made a change here this year. Damian Faulkner is running a great race right now, even with the penalties, all the way up to 11th. What are your plans the rest of this program and for next year?
Yeah, thanks, Darren. You know, we're really excited to be racing back here in the Continental Challenge Series. We were in and out this year a little bit, but we're working really hard to put together, you know, all of our programs for next year. This new association with Aston Martin Racing has been, it's been a lot, you know, taking it all in this year. And after, like you said, a 20-year successful relationship with Porsche, it was a big decision for us, but it's got so many good opportunities associated with it. So we're working real hard on our GT front and our Continental Challenge front to have some solid programs on the table for next year, as well as supporting any of the teams that want to come race with us.
Great. The Damian Faulkner car is fast, so it's looking like a good run for you guys.
He's cranking, and I got James Davison, the open wheel kid. We wanted to go all in on this last race. Damian's a fantastic driver. He's been our TRG driver all year, so he's out there pedaling the car, even though we had to get through the field a little bit, and then we're getting ready for this afternoon's race too. So really happy to be here. It's a beautiful day in Lime Rock, what can you say? Also, everyone's real excited about the schedule coming up and the unification, so we're pumped.
All right, thanks, Kevin.
Well, TRG still has a relationship with Porsche. They run a GT Challenge car in the American Le Mans Series. In fact, they won at the last round at Circuit of the Americas in Austin. So, and he still has Porsche customers in his Porsche parts business. So still very involved with Porsche, just now taking in Aston Martin as well.
Kevin is the ultimate multitasker. He's one of the busiest guys in the paddock and keeps working his programs. They're always beautifully run, beautifully prepared, and they're always quick. And Faulkner's now knocking on the door of a top 10 run here. Haven't had that early penalty. Jumped the start, got out of line. Here we see Dan on the inside of Don Salama. Gets into the top 10.
And you don't typically see a pass like that at the downhill, but Faulkner made that look easy. We keep talking about tire degradation. Chris, what are you hearing down in pit lane?
Well, we're getting to that point where we're going to start seeing some of these cars come into pit lane for that first pit stop, fuel and tires. And a lot of these teams making some adjustments, some air pressure adjustments, because we're chasing the temperature. When we started today, it was about 50 degrees. Track temp was 55. I just checked that track temp. It just crossed over 80 degrees, so it's gone up 25 degrees. And I think it's going to continue to go higher. So these teams starting to search for ways to get that car to work better.
And a lot of those teams, maybe Stevenson did that. You know, Edwards back a little bit at the beginning, but now running very strong. You have to make a guess at the beginning with tire pressures. They may not be good now, but you're trying to plan for down the road when the temperatures do come up. And perhaps Stevenson Motorsports had the best estimate of what was going to happen with that.
Well, he's certainly strong at the end of this stint. He's pulled 2.5 seconds on Tony's Kazmetz in a handful of laps here, Dorsey. So the pace is there. And what he's working on now is trying to create a nice cushion, because, you know, here, the short lap, if there's any snafu in pit lane, it can cost you dearly. So building a bit of a buffer now would be John Edwards' next task. He knows he's only got to make these tires last another 10 minutes or so. So burn them down and try and get as much speed and as much gap as you can on the rest of the field.
Yeah, it's kind of funny. You start out conservative, you're running toward the end of your stint, but at the end of your stint, you give up with getting conservative. You try to get as much gap as you can get, because that pit stop is coming for everybody. And remember, a pit stop here is a lap.
There's John Edwards as he heads into the left-hander. We say the left-hander because it's the only left-hand corner on the racetrack. You alluded to it earlier, Dorsey, when you talk about an asymmetrical setup. Something that will help the car turn to the right, you kind of throw away the left-hand corner. But Edwards 4 seconds now, Calvin, at the line the last time by.
You know, you take all the weight in the car that you can take and you put it to the right side because you're always turning right and the weight's getting biased to the left. You do all that and you set the setup on the chassis the same way. Ooh, to favor right-hand corners.
Look at this.
Don Salama loose coming up that uphill.
It's just impressive stuff by Edwards to pull out that lead.
Actually,
there's Tony Kazemit in the 71 and then the 55, Jade Buford running in third, the 96 car. Down a lap, Paul Dalla-Lana, so they're working their way past lap traffic. So right now, John Edwards in his Camaro has really taken it to the Aston Martins from Multimatic. Edwards lead, and he's building on that lead, but still a long way to go. Just over an hour and a half from Lime Rock Park in the season finale of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. 1 hour and 35 minutes to go, and John Edwards in his number 9 Camaro ready for the first pit stop of the day for the Stevenson Motorsports team. Interesting to see if they change drivers on this stop. So they were able to go 55 minutes to get this done. And Edwards down pit road to his box. Chris?
Yeah, great run by John Edwards. Really having to work his way through traffic. Matt Bell going to take over on this stop. So the team going to do 4 tires. They've got the left side tires out. They've got right side tires hanging over the wall. So it'd be interesting to see, does this team decide to do 2 tires or all 4 on this stop? Going to be a big fuel stop. John Edwards slowly walking his way across the wall and jumping over. We'll get a word with him as soon as he gets his helmet off. Yep, and we're coming over to the right side. Looks like we're just going to do the right rear on this stop. Right now, just crossing over 21, 24 seconds. Oh, we're doing a right front too. So this team going 4 tires and fuel.
I guess it makes sense. If you're going to put that driver in and run him for the next hour and a half, give him a good, stable platform from which to start. And on the last stop, that may be your 2-tire, 3-tire stop.
Working on tires a little bit, though, so it did cost him maybe about 5 seconds. That was about 43, 44 seconds.
14's in the wall. He's going to keep going, though. Plus, that gives him all 4 tires to look at as far as making that decision later about going with 2 or going with 3. Now Mike Johnson has the ability to look at all 4 of those tires off the Camaro and see what his decision will be later on.
Brad Yeager in the number 14 Nissan spun onto the front straightaway. I wonder if he was trying to get the car over to pit lane so quickly, just lost it as he came through the downhill, and now he's to his marks.
Kevin Darren there looking on, and this is our pole sitter. He's in. Darren?
Both the 48 and the 45 are in, and they're a surprise that the 9 car came in as early as it did. They went another lap or two past them. These guys can make fuel, so this won't be the last stop, but they're going to put on 4 tires, 4 brand new Continentals, and Charles Espenlob is back in the car and getting ready to head back out.
See, I agree with that 4-tire stop right now. It gives you the opportunity to measure tread wear, look at what kind of wear you're getting on the race, because the next stop is the crucial one, probably their last one, and it might go with just 2 or maybe 3.
And you probably can't go the whole way just with left side, so it means they do have the opportunity of just doing left sides possibly on the final stop where it'll be a shorter fuel fill.
Al Carter moving into the seat of the 45 BMW, and he is out. So really, the 9 car started that cascade of pit stops as they came in. John Edwards, what a great job he did in that opening stint, Chris.
Yeah, he came from 7th on the grid all the way to the front. And John, one thing we're noticing is lots of cars moving around out there. The track temp has come way up. Have you guys lost a lot of grip?
Well, it's been that way all morning. Even when it was cold in Rolex qualifying, we lost a lot of grip compared to yesterday. So I don't know what to attribute it to, but I would have said if we were testing here by ourselves that we need to work a lot on the setup, but apparently it's the track and everyone seems to be struggling. So our car's dealing with it a little better than some of the Astons were. So we were able to work our way up, but still a long way to go. And as you know, in Continental, anything can happen.
Right before that stop, I asked Mike Johnson, your team manager, if you guys were going to make any changes on the stop, and he shook me off, said no. You think that's the right call?
Yeah, I think it's the right call. Matt and I like a little bit different car. He likes the car to rotate a little on entry and really set it up early. I like to carry speed on entry and then rotate mid-corner. And, you know, both ways work, but I think the car's a little more suited to Matt, so it made more sense to leave the car, see how he likes it. If he needs a change late in the race and we make another stop, then we'll do that.
Well, we'll see if that's the right call. Darren?
Trent, you had a great qualifying run to start the weekend here, and you've had a great run in the race. You led most of it and fell back a little bit towards the end there. How's the car?
You know, car's pretty good right now. It's definitely difficult in the later stages of the run, just with the condition of the tires. But overall, car was really, really well balanced all time. Big thanks to all these fall line guys for giving me a good car. We're able to lead a couple laps there and get out front, and I was very happy about that. So, you know, my main goal was just to bring the car in for Charles in one piece, and luckily I did. But overall, just big thanks to all these fall line guys, you know, all my sponsors, Sirocco Nozimo, Atlas Akon Electrical Corporation. You know, that BMW was awesome today, and, you know, just can't thank those guys enough.
So what's fallen off as far as from the grip? Is it the rear of the car as the stint goes on?
Yeah, it seems to be the left rear. You know, it just, there's so many right-hand corners on this track. You know, it does come out to be the left rear. But it eventually gets pretty difficult to put the power down. But overall, you know, the car was definitely drivable. Definitely didn't have any major issues with it. So, you know, it's good. Let's see what Charles can do.
All right, guys, keep an eye on the rear end of those things throughout the stint.
Speaking of the rear end.
Yeah, he said the left rear
yeah,
was left going
rear
off.
Bumper
really
cover's
the left,
starting to fall off.
Almost.
It's going to be a little aero drag.
Will Turner taking over in the 97 BMW from Turner Motorsports.
Home track for these guys, yeah. And Will was really pumped up about returning to his favorite track. He and Don Salama typically on the pit wall, calling the shots, and they'll be having a lot of fun here this weekend. A lot of fans, a lot of family on hand to watch this.
Yeah, you can't pass that up.
No.
In your backyard.
Yep. Both good drivers. I mean, both able to win these races, even though they sit on the box and they call the shots, and they do a really good job of that, too.
I bet Salama was still calling strategy even driving.
I bet he was. I bet he was.
Joey Atterbury now takes over the point, but we would expect to see him soon. He'd been on the radio earlier saying, I'm faster than Jack Roush Jr. in the 61 of the team car in front. In the majority of the areas of the racetrack, he just couldn't get by him. Well, now they'll see if they can get by him on pit road. Atterbury able to pull out a bit of a lead. Team's going to need a good stop to get him back out in front of the 61. Chris?
Yeah, they've got about an 11-second lead right now. Interesting to see this team being able to stretch the fuel a good four laps longer than that Camaro. So, obviously, getting good fuel economy right now. Taking a look at the left rear coming off this car, it looks like it's in good shape, too. So, it looks like the tire's working well in the car. But a little bit of a slow stop here. Left rear slow on the lugs there. So, it might be a little bit slower than what we saw from some of these other stops.
One of the Aston Martins in, and Billy Johnson taking over in the 61. He's out there, and expect to see a driver change in the 51. There's the 15. And this looks to be a routine stop. That was pretty quick if you get the door closed.
Yeah.
Oh. They've got
look at the problem with the window net.
See, it's just any little hiccup, Cal.
Yeah, just different driver pairing here this weekend. Hamilton in there with Scott Maxwell. So, you know, this is something that you have to rehearse and have to get right.
Now he
get
can't
a gear.
Find a
get
gear.
A gear.
it was a good stop until the bumble driver change.
My mistake there. It's not Maxwell. It's Mancuso. Nick Mancuso has had a couple of podium runs here this year. So, little bobble.
So Shelby Blackstock will take over for Joey Atterbury in the 51. The first round of pit stops cycle through. It's the season finale for Grand Sport in the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. And there's still nearly an hour and a half to go. Out in front, nope, it's the 9. John Edwards out, Matt Bell behind the wheel now. And this team has had some great runs. They just wish they could make Indianapolis and Road America go away. 20th. Was the finish at Indianapolis, Road America 17th, and really that's what took him out of being a little bit more of a contender in the championship, Chris.
Well, they're just playing cool customers today. Just checked in with Mike Johnson, very relaxed up on the booth, very happy with what the car is doing and the lead that they have out there. He said they pretty much broke this race up into three different segments. They ran for an hour. They're running for a half an hour now before they bring Matt Bell back into pit lane to do that last hour run. So on this next stop, just going to be a two-tire change, left side tires on that Camaro, because it's only going to need about a half a tank of fuel to get that car full.
I think that's the key. With the lead and by only needing half a tank of fuel, two tire change, Chris, they may be able to just stay on that lead lap. It should be about a 20 to 25 second pit stop, about 25 seconds lost on pit lane in terms of the delta. So when you're leading, that could keep you on the lead lap, and that is really important here at Lime Rock Park.
Give you a 10 second cushion plus whatever it is between you and second place,
okay,
whatever that number is, should be what they should come out on a perfect pit stop. Right now it's 9.7 seconds, so.
That was at the line the last time by. There's the 48 of Charles Espenlob. Just heard his radio. He's got that damage to that valance in the back, the bumper. It's not really doing a lot of harm right now. Limerock, not a real high-speed racetrack, but it'll be interesting to see if the crew just grabs it and removes the entire bumper.
Or just put a screw back into it just to hold it back in place.
Better bear bond, I would think. If you start pulling on that thing, you could really have a problem because you may not be able to tear it off completely. Yeah.
Right now, it's bending back far enough that if it bends just a little bit more, it won't be much of a problem at all. And as long as it's not going to black flag you for it for falling off, which right now it looks pretty secure. It's got a little aero drag, but like you say, Brian, this isn't the highest speed of places.
And Espenlob with a huge lead over third, which is the 71 of Michael Marcel. When we looked at Espenlob coming down the front straightaway, the 71, the white Aston Martin that flashes by, wasn't even in the picture, wasn't through the apex of the downhill, but there he is. He's got a rearview mirror full of the red number 61. Driven by Billy Johnson, who took that car over from Jack Roush Jr.
And Billy's moved up. Yeah, he's really come up a long way. He's gotten past the 51 with Shelby Blackstock in it. And now he's caught the Aston. Looks to be faster, I think, Cal.
Yeah, and you talked about bookending the season at the start of the show, Dorsey. They started the year with a win at Daytona. Come close on a couple other occasions. Not been the championship run they're looking for. But Marcel and Billy Johnson have been teammates this year with the Turner Motorsports program. So I'm sure they'll be a little bit kinder to each other than they normally would if they were, you know, fiercer competitors.
Talk about a disappointing season. After that win, they've only ever had one other top five finish this year. It was the second place at Indianapolis. So Billy Johnson wants to get this season turned around.
And Shelby Blackstock and the other cars only, you know, you're talking about two cars are running fourth and sixth right now. So
Johnson,
not bad.
Dropping wheels at the exit of the downhill, though. He is pushing hard, trying to get past Marcel in front. They haven't had the season they wanted. The 71, and we talked about the woes for Aston Martin earlier. Very quick, but crew mistakes, driver mistakes, mechanical errors.
Well, they had those braking issues, remember? I mean, Michael had one at Mid-Ohio going up in the keyhole, and then we saw that really weird one with Tony's Kazimitz at Indianapolis. So that's really thrown them a bit of a curveball in terms of the damage and identifying what the problem was with the braking system.
Remember, Matt Plum and Rum Bum Porsche, the 13 car back there, has nothing to lose now. They've won the championship, so he's going to be extremely aggressive, too.
Well, and Cal, you're talking about those Aston Martins and the braking issue. You can also think about some of the computer issues they have with that car, the fly-by-wire throttle system in the car. And, you know, talking to the team, they did so much development on the handling of this car, but there's not a lot that they can do with the computer system. That all goes back to AMR over in England. So the team really hasn't been able to get any of that sorted out in Canada. And they've done a great job with gaining speed on the racetrack, but just some of the computer issues with that car haven't completely been sorted.
Well, you have to keep in mind is Billy Johnson really working over Michael Marcel, and Matt Plum could be the beneficiary of all of this if it goes wrong. These cars are effectively street cars turned into race cars, and a lot of times the computer system's designed to keep you safe on the street really isn't what you want when it comes time to go racing.
Yeah, it's hard to disarm a lot of those systems, and it's really a lot of magic that goes to work on those electronic systems to make them perform on the racetrack. You want to disarm like a lot of the stability control systems, Dorsey, and that's not easy to do.
A lot of these engines have anti-knock sensors. Of course, when you're on a racetrack and you're clanging around and banging, well, the engine's not knocking, but it's like maybe the exhaust pipe's hitting the frame. Well, the computer says, well, something's knocking, I'm gonna, you know, pull it all back. So it is tough to disarm the ones. I think Billy Johnson's being so aggressive because of the fact that he's got the Rum Bum Porsche being aggressive on his tail.
The Mustangs, however, don't seem to have the ultimate pace. Looking at the fastest lap of the 51 and the 61, they're about 7/10 off the fastest laps turned in this race. So here we see Brian Sellers forcing down at the inside there with a 46 car. It's a team that's had a couple of victories mid-season this year. Indianapolis and
the Ford guys have been complaining all year about the weight of that car. It's the heaviest car in the field, and you know they're politicking all the time, but quite honestly they just haven't been up to snuff this year.
But you got to give Shelby Blackstock a lot of credit. Here's a kid who has been racing in an open wheel series in Star Mazda, and then over here in a heavy sedan. He's running well in both of them, and it's really just about an education process and a development process as a driver for him. And he is developing well.
I talked to him yesterday, and I said, how much did the open wheel help you? And he said, a ton, more than you can imagine. He goes, it showed me how to race. You know, that those guys over there are really doing a good job. He goes, I'm going back. He goes, I'm going back for a second year. I said, that's really a good thing to know. He had a really tough competitor this year.
The loose-off is especially high speed.
Shelby right there saying the loose off the high-speed corners, that would be the downhill in West Bend car. Not to his liking on board the 45. Al Carter being shown in seventh in his fall line BMW.
one podium run on the season. They've had three podiums together, Al Carter and Hugh Plum. And they were looking for bigger and better things this year as another one of those teams that had a few mechanical gremlins. The four-line team had some driveline issues, engine problems mid-season that really confused them, but they've regrouped nicely and consistently one of the fastest and top teams in this paddock.
The wins have really been spread around when you look at it. It's been six different teams who've had a victory this year, and Sellers really pressing hard. And for Shelby Blackstock, he needs to understand that Brian Sellers is a lap down. Yeah. Let that fight go.
Yeah, let him go a little bit and just fall in line. And if Brian's got the pace, just go with him. Just go chase the leaders.
Pretty much had that happen right there. Just you guys were talking about it. He kind of backed off and let Brian go up for the downhill so they didn't go through side by side, which is the right thing to do.
That 46 is not the lead lap either. So
there you go. The crew telling him he's not on the lead lap. Yeah. From Shelby Blackstock back to seventh is the number seven.
Hey guys, if it wasn't for that early penalty, the drive-through penalty on the seven Aston Martin of TRG early in the race, those guys would be in the thick of it. They're sitting ninth in the last car on the lead lap, but watching timing and scoring, they have consistently been the fastest car almost every lap. So if we get a yellow flag, I'd say keep an eye out. That thing's quick.
Calvin, you talked about it at the beginning of the show, the fact that not running with the ST cars this weekend, you can't count on those cautions. A caution would have put this car right back in the hunt and still would, but we are caution free right now.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's just a shame that Damian got caught out there on the initial start, got that penalty, but the car's been fast. James Davison has Conti experience, ran the Mustang earlier this year as he's kicking up the dust. You're just showing your age, Brian. I get nervous.
I get scared here. Can imagine what I'd be like in a car. And obviously, I wasn't reading the screen very well. Davison in eighth in his number seven. So you look back, it's Davison, then Maxwell in the 55 in ninth, and Mancuso in another Aston Martin.
Man,
exciting stuff. But for Matt Bell and his Stevenson Motorsports Camaro, they still lead in the final round, the 2013 Grand Sport Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. Grand Sport from the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge continues the final round of the 2013 season from Lime Rock Park. 47 minutes to go, and James Davison in his Aston Martin currently leading. But I don't know that the 7 has made their final pit stop. But let's get you up to speed with what's been going on. I was scared earlier. Well, take a look at the 78.
Yeah, that was a hairy moment through the downhill. Did well to hang on to that one.
I can't deal with that. And then you've got the 15, Nick Mancuso, off in turn one.
This was a broken left front suspension that sent Nick into a lurid slide. And you'll see once he gets going again, that the left front is flopping all over the place.
And then pit stops.
No tires here for the Rum Bum team. Just a quick top up, about 14 seconds on pit lane. And then we saw a little bit of argy bargy there as Matt Bell is trying to make his way to pit lane. Got a little bit of rub and go there from Billy Johnson.
But that Rum Bum stop was very, very quick. The 71 was also in.
See left sides for them. And then four tire change for Charles Espenlab. This is definitely going to cost you a bit of time here on pit lane because the fueling is a lot quicker with only half a tank full going on board.
Interesting to see the different strategy playing out on that last round of stops, Chris.
That's right, Brian. I was down at the 9 car on that stop. They took left side tires, but the problem there was fueling. They didn't get the fuel rig connected right, so it was about a 5 to 10 second stop longer than they anticipated. Gave up a lot of track position to the 13 car. And Joe Vardy was the man that made that call. Joe, you called no tires on your stop. Very quick on the fuel. You guys going to be able to keep that car under Matt Plum for the entire run, though.
Well, we were at a 30-second deficit before the stop, and we had to do something to close that down. So we decided to go no tires. Matt's a pretty good driver. He's kind of in a not in a real good position right now with no tires, but he'll have to just do what he can do, and that's it.
Yeah. Yeah, well, these guys are not only going to try and close out. Well, they've already closed out the championship, but trying to get a win today. And, guys, looking back at that 15 car spinning down in turn one, I did check in with Multimatic. They said the suspension on that left front corner was fine. The issue was the ABS on that car. Another computer problem with the Aston Martin. The ABS was not working effectively, sent that car into a slide.
Well, and that's the thing. You've got one of those systems that you trust, and then it fails or has a hiccup in it, and then you can't trust it. So what do you do the next time you come into the corner? How hard do you brake?
Well, I mean, once you lose your confidence in the brake system in the car, it's a really bad deal, and these cars have had that. That's the worst kind of scenario is have.
That was weird, though. I mean, we didn't have a great shot of it. The suspension was really oscillating after the incident, and I think that the suspension had an issue before you hit the tire wall. The tire wall wasn't a big enough bang to really do any damage that would create that kind of issue. So something's amiss there with the Aston, which is a disappointing end to what had been a pretty productive year for Nick Mancuso.
Billy Johnson in the red, number 61 Mustang, putting pressure on Matt Plum. And Joe Vardy saying he didn't have a great car underneath him, but he's running times that are consistent with James Davison, who is our leader, and Matt Bell, who's running second. So Plum almost matches to the hundredth of a second the lap time of Billy Johnson right behind him. So that Porsche has been fairly kind to the Continental tires that are on it right now. James Davison still has a stop to go. Will Matt Bell and John Edwards, will they take a victory in the final round of 2013? We'll find out when we come back to Lime Rock Park. Billy Johnson and Matt Plum had been in an intense battle for third position here from Lime Rock Park, the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. It was Matt Plum and his number 13 Rum Bum Porsche that had the point there in that battle, but Billy Johnson making quick work out of letting his frustrations be known, took the red Mustang past the Porsche down the front straightaway, and I think Matt Bell probably understood that it wasn't going to turn out so well if he continued to block the way that he was. Here's the pass.
Well, I think the call came from Joe Vardy. The Rum Bum Porsche just said, just let him go. He's going to wreck you. We're both going to wreck, and we got a long way to go. Just let it happen.
Well, it's not like there's only 5 minutes left. We've still got 40 minutes on the board. So that's a long time to hang on. And
Billy was... Billy was all over him, and with no tires on the Rum Bum Porsche, I mean, that car is a handful.
And this should ultimately be for the second position today, because James Davison leads this race, but will definitely need to hit pit lane again for some fuel. Matt Bell currently runs second.
11 seconds in front of you. You cut it down from about 14. And then the leader is like 19 seconds in front of you.
Billy Johnson's going to run away from this. He was really getting held up. I mean, it's so hard to pass here at Lime Rock.
Heard the 61 radio trying to give him positions and tell him where he was, where his competition is, what his fuel situation was. And for Matt Plum right now, that smoke has continued out of the Porsche. It's maybe not quite as bad as it was earlier, but Dorsey,
I don't think it's going to hurt it. I think he's just running it real rich.
Yeah, I think they must be, but I'll go back to when it finally stops. Does it stop because there's no more oil?
Yeah, I don't think it'll stop.
I
think it'll stay like that throughout the race. I've seen it during the year do this before. I think it's when he puts it on a real fat map, you know, fuel map, and just be conservative.
I think the big question right now, guys, is can Billy Johnson run down Matt Bell? Because ultimately that will be for the win of the motor race here today. He's 11 seconds behind Matt Bell right now. And question is, they didn't do four tires. So just got to see who has the pace right now. We haven't seen it in ultimate lap time from the Roush cars today, but Matt Bell should assume the lead of this motor race once this seven car pits for the final time. And then it'll be down to, can Billy Johnson chase down Matt Bell and bookend that season like you talked about at the start of the show, Dorsey?
It would be nice for him, too, because they really have struggled. It's been not the year that anybody thought they would have, to be honest with you. We thought that'd be a really solid team this year after they came out so strong.
What I don't understand, Kevin Buckler, a master of strategy. We've got 38 minutes left in this race. James Davison, almost 9-second lead. He's well within his window to stop, and I would have expected to see that car on pit road by now.
I think stop, get the stop done, take a couple of tires, and then just pray for yellow. You're not going to chase these guys down. But what are you thinking, Darren?
Well, just talking with Kevin Buckley, you guys are right. There's no way they're going to win this. And so his strategy right now is if it's going to stay green, they're going to run it as long as they can, come in for two tires, short field of fuel, try and make that as quick as possible. But he's actually hoping for a yellow. And if he does get it, again, it's a short field and possibly four tires. And then he's got fresh tires for the final run. So they're going to run it as long as they can.
But the key for me is you want to get those tires on before the yellow. If it goes yellow, then you come in, you're going to be at the back of the pack. I mean, he's leading the motor race now. Get those two tires on, stay on the lead lap, and then you're going to get bunched back up. I think if he waits for the yellow to do the final stop, they're going to lose a lot of track position potentially.
Well, and you do that stop now, you've got 35 plus minutes to work your way back up to the front with good tires on it. If you get the yellow, it's just that much more of a bonus. So yeah, just so many different ways to play it. Kevin certainly one of the masters of strategy, but he's played his cards. That's what he's going to do. And you see Matt Bell with just a little bit of a slide through the left-hander. He's our de facto leader, because with James Davison has to pit, you got to figure that he's going to move to the front. So it'll be interesting. That Camaro looks like it's working well. John Edwards said earlier it's probably a little better suited to Matt Bell's driving style, and it certainly seems to be working. James Davison not leaving anything on the table.
No, he's pushing hard, and this is a really impressive young driver. I mean, been working hard over the last few years to really establish himself here in North American racing, come up through the single seater ranks, certainly taking a look at sports cars as well. But he got that moment down in turn one.
What a save. That was a big tank slapper going on.
That's an indication of how hard he is pushing this race car. But had his IndyCar debut at Sonoma a few weeks ago and did a brilliant job there, really mixing it up in the top 10.
Take a look. Another Aston Martin with a bit of a braking issue. Is this one a driver-induced issue?
Well, it got a wiggle, and when it wiggles like that, it throws the weight back and forth. What was good about that was he had three corrections in that. You know, he had the first correction for the slide, then he had to get on the brakes to slow it down some more while it was still straight. That put it back into a second slide. He fixed that one too, and then he went ahead and scrubbed enough speed to make the corner. So there's a lot going on right there.
In a tenth of a second.
Yeah, all within about a tenth of a second. He read it perfectly is what I'm trying to tell you. He didn't do anything wrong right there except the initiation of the slide.
That'll be interesting to see. It was 9.8 seconds at the line the last time by, and then he had the problem in turn one. So we'll have to see where his margin is to Matt Bell. Bell just coming into the shot there through the downhill. So Davison across the line. Bell will come. It was 9.8 seconds the last lap. 9.5, so 3/10 of a second. James Davison continuing to hold down the point. Strategy changing at TRG?
Kevin, we've been talking about the strategy and you guys staying out, possibly trying to short fill two tires on green. You've got, you still have to come in no matter what. What are you thinking?
Yeah, absolutely. On these short tracks, so you gotta be really careful. Everybody rushes to be the first car in, but if you don't get out before the leader comes by, you're gonna get lapped. Right now it's a 12 car race, so anyone behind us is down a lap. We're gonna stay out. We're pushing it the other direction, a little reversal here. If it goes yellow, we're coming in, taking a leisurely four tires and racing everybody to the end with fresh tires. So otherwise, we're going to take two tires and go. You know, we're off a little bit because of that penalty in the beginning, so we had to play these cards, and I think this is the right way to go.
Again, guys, cards have been dealt a certain way. The car's been fast. We'll see how it ends up.
I guess the big difference is there, if it's under yellow, they'll take four versus two under green. So that would give him a little bit more grip, possibly a little bit better lap time.
Ooh, out wide again.
Yeah, he's struggling for grip here. I mean, they got to look at that as well. You don't want to throw away, which is a potentially good run here today.
Yeah, he's up to 9.9 second lead. And if that diminishes, then it really begins to challenge and diminish the options that Kevin Buckler has. So for James Davison, he's out in front right now. But strategy and a little bit of luck, can that keep him there? We'll find out when we come back to Lime Rock. Lime Rock Park. 29 minutes to go in the 2013 season. James Davison, the lead, it's diminishing, and that car, I think the Continental tires are done. And I think they were done about 15 minutes ago.
He's driving like he's on ice. I mean, that is very, very loose. This Aston's skating all over the racetrack.
He's had 60 laps on these tires.
That's a long way.
It's a lot of work. He's done a great job, though, adapting to this car. Basically got thrown in at the deep end this weekend, but boy can certainly pedal a race car.
Man, he is holding on. There is second place, the number nine from Stevenson Motorsports, the Camaro, and Matt Bell, 8.2, so it's kind of hanging around the same area. Bell pressing hard, but the balance on the Camaro seems much better than that on the Aston Martin. Of course, the tire's much fresher.
Yeah, and I mean, that's really, I mean, he knows that the Aston has to come, so he's not really racing the Aston for the win. He's racing the guy behind him, which is Billy Johnson, so I'm sure he's just getting the gaps from Mike Johnson over the radio.
15 laps, the gap to the 61's been 11.7, then 10.7, then 7.7, now back up to 8.7. 27 minutes to go. Just keep doing what you're doing, bud. We got Lawson there to help if we need it.
Good timing, Jeff.
You're going to have to be real consistent lap times, real consistent.
It's Mike Johnson.
Sorry about that.
Sorry about that. Matt Bell replying about how he feels like the handling may not be perfect from what I could hear on that. So pressing, and he's, you heard Mike Johnson say, we've got Lawson Auchinbach if we need him, and that's the 0-1,
yeah,
another
Camaro.
He's got a
wingman there, so if Billy Johnson starts to come after him, One of the GM boys is going to back you up there, but they're on the same straightaway here. So Billy Johnson, once he can see Matt Bell, that's going to make him dig a little bit deeper. Dorsey, even though the car may be run ragged, it's amazing how you can find an extra tenth or two when you can get a sniff of that lead.
Yeah, once you smell the blood, man, you're after him for sure. But I kind of wonder how much did he use up his tires fighting with Matt Plum in the Rum Bum course right there that he finally did get around. You know, how much is left under the 61?
Well, now the 61 is going to have to deal with some lap traffic. The number 35 right in front, Andrew Aquilante in another Mustang, and they had Nick Galante that they had to deal with, and that's really kind of separated Billy Johnson from Matt Plum. As you look a little bit further back, you see the number 13 Porsche, and it's that traffic that can work for you or work against you. And we'll move back a little bit further to the battle for seventh. BJ Zacharias in the number 14 Nissan, and he's got a rear view mirror full of Aston Martin, the 71 of Michael Marsall.
BJ's run this car all year long, so he's the primary driver that's used to the car, and it's Kevin Durant's car. We're talking about the 14 Nissan there. He's moving up. That car's been really competitive at the end of the season.
Tell you what, who's also coming in the picture is Billy Orblin there in the yellow and blue Turner Motorsports BMW. Is going to be going through the frame right there. He is really caught up, essentially went down a lap early in the stint here with the 96, but Billy's drug it back up onto that lead lap, and he's pushing hard, just digging deep here in the final race of the championship.
Talk about the final race in the championship. There's been plenty of action throughout the day. It'll give you a little race recap, keep you up to date with what's been happening as you see BJ Zacharias come to pit road. So at the beginning, Trent Hinman, what a spectacular job by the 18-year-old, qualifies on pole, goes wheel to wheel with Tonis Kazmetz in the Aston Martin. From the get-go, it was 30 minutes that the 13 needed to claim the championship. They got that done.
And there was a great battle here between John Edwards and Trent Hinman. And Edwards took it to the front by getting this pass done on Tonis Kazmetz down in the break zone for turn one.
These two had at it. Billy Johnson working with the Rum Bum Porsche. Took it a long time and a lot of effort. He did win. Got by.
James Davison, our leader in. Darren?
Well, just as we talked about, they came in two tires and they're just giving it a splash, although this is a long splash. You know, I know when these guys come in with those four out as they were, it's going to be so nice for them on the fresh tires. But I think they played their cards and did all they could to try and get it to the end and make up what they could from the early issue.
Bit conservative there on the splash, though. It seemed like that refueling rig was connected probably a bit longer than it needed to be. But you don't want to run out. Otherwise, you look like a real fool if you do that in terms of a short fill. There he is, struggling for grip here, trying to get those left sides up to temp.
He drops back into the battle there in about seventh or eighth on the racetrack. So James Davison trying to work his way back up to the front. They've played their final hand. We'll be back to more from Lime Rock. It's the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. Matt Bell leading at Lime Rock Park. He's got his wingman right behind him, the 0-1 of Lawson Auschenbach. Auschenbach not for position, but he can help defend from Billy Johnson if Billy Johnson can get his Ford Mustang a little closer to Matt Bell. But right now, Johnson about 5.5 seconds at the line the last time by, and there he is, Billy Johnson, just coming through turn two as Matt Bell heads through the left-hander.
Talking about manufacturer points, and that's why that's happening like that. Matt Bell doing fine up front there, but to have a wingman, another Chevrolet back there with a Ford chasing you down, well, that gives you two bullets of the one.
Yeah, if you don't think the manufacturer bragging rights are important, you see it right here. And Lawson Auschenbach is just going to park right there. He's sharing that 0-1 this weekend with Ashley McCalmont after the team lost a car at the last round at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. Lawson Auschenbach being shown in 11th. He's a lap down to Matt Bell, so he'll stay right there. And he'll try to protect Bell as much as possible over this remaining 20 minutes as Billy Johnson tries to close down. James Davison had been leading, came in, and then Will Turner was about to come to the pits, and I think it caught Davison off guard coming through the downhill.
Yeah, Will slows here a little bit. He's slowing right at apex. James Goose commits to the right, and then Will stays right to try and get to pit lane. It was a great save by Will Turner.
Yeah, it was.
He was certainly on his toes there, and no harm, no foul, but James was just caught unawares by the intention of Will Turner to hit pit lane for his final stop.
Yeah, I mean, if you're in really close quarters like that, if you're the car coming into pit lane, what you need to do is stick your right hand up and wave it. Don't point, but just wave back and forth. Like, just let the guy know, hey, I'm about to do something here.
48, Charles Espenlaw running fourth right now. He's the 2010 Grand Sport champion. Car's directly behind him right now. Lap down. They don't really matter for position, but it doesn't mean they're not racing hard anyway.
The 05 is Nick Galante. He has no rear tires on that Mustang. And you talk about sliding. Watch that car. He has been spectacular the last two laps.
What happens when you try to stretch the life out of one of those Continental tires and you stretch a little too far? Well, you're in a drift machine, and Galante doing a great job holding on in his copy Mustang. But the rear tires, you said it, just completely.
Look at that. That is a spectacular show that this 78 car's been looking at for many laps now by Nick Galante right in front of him.
Yeah. David Levine in the 78 there doesn't want to get too close, because watch this when they head into one and two. Oh, 158 slides under, but Galante has his hands absolutely full of that Mustang.
Ian James slides through.
So does the 51 of Shelby Blackstock. So now you've got cars on the lead lap working their way through cars that are a lap down.
These are all Ford Mustangs too, so you got to wonder if they're going to try to help each other like the Chevrolet guys are doing up front. This is what we're talking about with the 05. This is spectacular. Gets down in.
Hello.
Oh boy, I got nothing at the back end.
I got this. I got this.
He's having fun.
Well, he's done this now, he's got good car control, that's for sure. He's proven that to us.
Well, he's showing the side of that Mustang to all the fans on the hill. He's making sure that his sponsors get good exposure, because he's showing the side of the car as he slides around the corner. And there it is again. Every time you come into the downhill, he's got to just be holding his breath.
Yeah. Oh, that's fear factor there. Every time he turns for a corner more than about 10 degrees, he gets the opposite lock right away.
Holding on to that copy Mustang as much as he possibly can. And now the 158.
Yeah, Ian James saying, I don't want any part of
no,
it.
Let I me mean, try. No.
Look at him.
Yeah.
It's a show.
It's like he's driving on ice. So Galante knows there's 17 minutes remaining. That's got to feel like an hour and 17 minutes to him. He's got his hands full. Matt Bell has his hands full of a lead. But Billy Johnson has closed it to 3.5 seconds. This is going to be a race to the checkered flag. Billy Johnson's going to make sure of that. Looking at Lime Rock Park, just 1 year ago, there were 6 full course cautions for a total of 27 laps in the Grand Sport division of the Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge. This year, 0 cautions, 137 laps, about to be 138 as the number 9 comes across the line. Matt Bell trying to hold on to the lead, but the second car in line that you see behind him, the red 61, the Mustang of Billy Johnson, in just the last 3 laps has closed from 3.5 to 1.5 seconds.
Been a very impressive stint here by Billy Johnson. He got up to that second spot and has just dug deep, got his head down, driven some really consistent fast laps, and he has inched ever closer to our leader. So you've got a leader, Matt Bell, and he's got his wingman, Lawson Auchinback, who's a lap down between he and Billy Johnson.
The 01 black car is Lawson Auchinback. That's the Chevrolet Camaro. That's exactly what you're talking about, Calvin. The 61 Ford Mustang doesn't need to fight with him. He wants to get up to this number 9 Camaro. It's Auchinback's job not to let that happen, but he's a lap car, so I mean, you got to watch now. Things could get ugly.
I mean, the officials are going to be on the radio saying, don't make this too difficult.
No.
But if he can just hold him up for a couple of seconds, that's going to help Matt Bell. But remember, Billy Johnson, Jack Roush Jr., a lot of pride at stake. You guys talked about it at the beginning of the show. They won the first race of the year. They've had a miserable season.
Yeah.
And they really want to finish this season on a high note.
Well, Brian just checked in with Mike Johnson again, checking out the condition of that 9 car, that Stevenson Camaro, and he said Matt Bell really has his hands full right now. That car just sliding all over the place. You remember that last pit stop, just taking left side tires. That may be something that if they lose this lead, could ultimately have been that decision where they needed to go 4 tires. This track temp has come way up, now close to 100 degrees out here, where it started at 55 this morning.
I think Billy Johnson's going to let Lawson block him for a lap or two, and then he's going to send him for a ride. I mean, if they don't do anything about it, that lap car shouldn't play into the win today, but it's going to.
Yeah, we're looking at 11:40 on the board here, so about 12 laps to go for these leaders of the motor race, and Billy Johnson can't afford to lose 2 or 3 laps here, trying to clear Austin. But Auchinback moves to the side, he hits pit lane, so now the path is clear for Billy Johnson to chase down Matt Bell. What does Matt Bell have left? We have to look at these lap times here and see how he responds.
Hey, guys, just talking with Billy Johnson's team. They said the car is good, he's fast, and they're going to catch him, they feel like, but they don't know if they can get by. They don't know if they have the time. The big issue they're wondering is they pitted a couple laps later than the 9 car, so they feel like tires may hang on just a bit longer than the 9.
Well, I think we may be seeing that right now with just over 11 minutes, right at 11 minutes right now. It should be about 11 laps, maybe 12, that they'll need to do. That's what Billy Johnson has ahead of him. That's what he's got to be able to get by, work by Matt Bell.
Both these drivers are tough customers. They both have excellent car control, and they both are willing to run 10 tenths or beyond to get the job done. So this is going to be a heads-up matchup right now.
This is going to be great. This is going to be two of the best in the business with superb car control. As you mentioned, there you see Billy Johnson using all of that through the downhill. They're going to wring every ounce out of these Continental tires to try and get that win today.
This is going to be a show for the crowd around here, no doubt, because these guys know how to slide cars. They know how to rough it up with one another, and they're willing to go there.
And it really is a matter of pride, because the Manufacturers' Championship is settled. Porsche has won that. The Drivers' Championship is settled. We talked about Matt Plum, Nick Longhi winning that. So this is a pride. It's Chevrolet versus Ford. It's Matt Bell versus Billy Johnson. It's Stevenson Motorsports versus Roush Racing. A matter of pride in the final race of the season. Who can take home the trophy? Who can drink the champagne and stand on the top step?
And that Roush group has not had a win since the first race of the year. They want to win so bad, you can taste it, and it's right there for Billy Johnson to get.
Two wins on the year for the number 9 car, for Edwards and Bell. They want a third, but it's going to be tough. Can they hang on?
Closing down in the final moments here at Lime Rock Park. Billy Johnson with the bit in his teeth in his Mustang, trying to close down on the lead. Continental Tire action from Lime Rock Park. Brian Till, Calvin Fish, Dorsey Schrader with you, and Billy Johnson has done it. He has closed in on the leader, Matt Bell. For Matt Plum and the 13 Rum Bum Porsche, he and Nick Longhi are going to win this championship. They'll ride in a comfortable third, but first is yet to be determined, because Billy Johnson, he's there, guys.
He might win the race from third, too, because these guys are about to get after it.
Yeah. Matt Plum could get that fourth win of the season, because this is going to get really interesting here. Forget the gap. It was about 4 tenths over the stripe. Now it's all about, can Matt Bell protect the inside line into some of these brake zones? Oh, look at that. A little bit sideways there coming up the uphill.
Now it's just down to where and how. How am I going to make it work? Where am I going to do it? And for Matt, you know, he's going to slide that Camaro all over the place and be as fat as he can on these corners.
But Billy Johnson has really kept the car underneath him. I like the way he's been driving this stint. Nice. He hasn't been sliding the car too much, and that will really pay dividends here in the final 6 minutes of this race.
And there are telltale signs for Matt Bell turning in a little bit early, under braking there in one. He doesn't want to turn the wheel. The car's not underneath him, like you say, Calvin. You can tell he's uncomfortable with the handling of the number 9, and Billy Johnson right there waiting to pounce. Should be 7 laps to go when they came across the line this last time.
Matt wants to turn in really shallow, really easy, and keep the car as straight as possible, knowing if he really loads it, side loads it, it's going to step out. He won't be able to get on the throttle, and Bill will be up inside. So he's going to have to be as wide as he can on corner entry and just be very gentle with that wheel.
Now Billy is really close to him. He can just analyze and really just see where Matt Bell is slipping around this racetrack. How can I really execute the pass? Where is he going to lose grip? How do I need to set him up?
Lap car in the way in a minute, too. I saw a car right in front of them. They're going to catch it.
And that's the key. I mean, we've got 21 cars that started this event right now, 17 still running. But the BMW comes to pit road, the 45 now out of the way, clear sailing.
Billy with a run. He's just showing right now. He's just showing substance or presence.
Seeing some of these guys hitting pit lane with only 5 minutes to go. I think they just got their fuel numbers a little bit wrong in terms of when they made that stop.
6 laps to go as the 45 takes on a little bit of extra fuel, and they will head back out. Al Carter behind the wheel. Billy Johnson waiting, but he doesn't have a lot of time to wait. Just over 5 minutes to go.
5 laps, maybe 6.
Where's the chink in the armor? Where's the opening? Where can he force Matt Bell into a mistake?
I've seen that Camaro step out on this uphill a lot. When he does that, that time it wasn't too bad.
But getting by into West Bend, this next right-hand corner right there, that is incredibly difficult.
This is the corner to set it up at right here. The run to the downhill. You get the speed, you back away, you get the momentum going, and you draft right down inside.
This is where he needs to get it. Just be on that pad a little bit earlier, then just draft him on this front straightaway. There's the team manager for Stevenson, Mike Johnson, looking at the radio.
Matt knows he's coming. He's protecting. Protects that line.
On your tail, following you in.
Bell defensive. Johnson to the outside.
He'll try to switch under.
Trying
right
to go
here.
The long way. Can't switch under yet.
Clear.
Now he drops back. That's not going to work. But every time he puts pressure on Bell.
Five
laps to go. Every time he makes Matt tighten that steering wheel, it rubs those Continental tires a little bit more. Bell trying to hold on.
Matt Bell is going to have to earn this one. Boy, has he got to be on his toes. He's got to just protect every possible attack that Billy Johnson throws at him here in the last five laps of this race.
I think Billy knows that Matt's tire weak right now. He's got to run him into these corners as deep as he can, make him use those tires even more.
And there in turn one and two, when he could hold him down to the inside and make him tighten the wheel, it put even more pressure on the tires.
He backed off that time. Billy backed away to get a run. This is what you do. You back off, get a run, and really carry that momentum all the way down. Now he's going to try to pop to the inside. Here he goes.
All right, now Matt Bell to the
right. That was reactionary.
Now, and he's got to be careful. You cannot move in reaction to the car behind you. And the officials are going to look at that.
Yeah, it may have been deceiving, though, from that camera angle from behind Dorsey. I don't think Billy Johnson was right on him. He had a run going, and Matt Bell said, hey, I'm going to take that inside line. I think if Johnson was any closer to him, then, there's a bobble. Can he set him up? He's got to wait and then just try and turn in behind him, cut underneath him. Matt Bell just got to protect. He's just got to slow things down.
Oh, and we're going to get a sportsmanship flag, a rolled black flag. They'll point it at Matt Bell at the next time he comes across the start-finish line, saying, no, no, no. If you do it again, there's the flag. If you do it again, you're going to be black flag. So they're warning Matt Bell about blocking.
And it's that reactionary deal. You saw the Billy Johnson pop to the inside to try to run up the inside, and Matt moved the Camaro in front to do the block.
Now,
when
he gets a little loose.
Yeah, he's going to do it again right now. He's got to move to the right-hand side of the racetrack. He's done it before, though. He's done it for like three laps in a row now. So he's showing consistency in that move. He's not reacting to Johnson trying to overtake him there.
Billy needs to run him down deep in the brake zone here and make those tires slip out from underneath the Camaro. He's working the outside again.
Three laps to go.
Now, as you said, Matt Bell can make the move on his own. He can come off the corner and drive anywhere he wants, but he needs to be the one who chooses first. If he moves and reacts to Billy Johnson, that's where the problem is.
That last lap was perfect for Matt Bell. He made his move first.
Remember, the right side tires have been on this Camaro since the very beginning. Okay, Johnson gets a run on him there. Is he going to get to the inside? No, he doesn't.
Might try again here in the uphill.
Not much braking, though, here, Dorsey.
No,
tough to make
enough.
It. Just got to force him. Just force him to get in there a little bit too deep. Look at that.
They both get loose up top.
Two of the best in the business going at it, Dorsey. Sideways action.
Brian Sellers right behind them and is not for position. Brian Sellers, I'm sure, is going to lay back from this battle, not be involved with it. His team's going to tell him that's the battle for the win.
One car back into the inside. Do it before he does.
You heard
there you go.
Mike Johnson.
There
you go. Do it before he does.
Good advice.
One car back. Following you in.
Two laps to go. Billy Johnson looking around the outside. Two laps to go in this race. Two laps to go in the season.
And Brian Sellers just moved in there to get a better look. He's not been part of this deal, but he wants to see what happens.
Yeah, he doesn't need to get involved in this because this would spoil a really good race here right now. Will Billy Johnson have the patience to deal with what Matt Bell is doing on the racetrack? I don't think he's doing anything wrong. He's just trying to win this motor race. But will Billy Johnson be able to handle that without roughing him up?
And I tell you what, 56 seconds left. That's a lap here. We're going to get a white. If we don't get a checker, it's going to be a white.
No, it'll be a white flag this time by. Brian Sellers backed off the battle a little bit. He wants to stay close enough to watch, but he's not going to insert himself into that battle. Billy, Matt Bell holding on.
Billy trying to set this up. He backed away again so he can get a run if it's possible.
Fans need to get on their feet down in Big Bend because if it's going to happen, it's going to have to happen on this lap down in these next couple of corners. He reacts right now. He gets over to the inside lane. Johnson to the left.
One lap to go in the 2013 season. Side by side. In the braking zone. Johnson looks to the outside. Can he do it here in turn
one? He's
going to get him. He's got the track position. Bell's going to run him out
wide. Now.
What a move by Billy Johnson. Now will Matt Bell have the grip? He doesn't. I don't think he's got it through the left-hander.
All right, he's going to rub him again right up here. Watch.
Johnson takes over the lead for now, but we still have a half a lap to go. What does Matt Bell have left? Johnson now to the point.
Superb piece of driving there by Billy Johnson to get the lead of this motor race.
He knew what was coming. He knew he was going to get roughed up and he was on the outside. He was ready for it.
Great clean driving by both of these pairs. Mike Johnson can't believe it.
Two corners left. What does Matt Bell have left? No tires, that's for certain.
He doesn't have the grip, Brian. He just doesn't have the grip to respond.
Through West Bend, through the downhill, one last time. Billy Johnson now pulling away. Billy Johnson, Jack Roush Jr., win number two. Billy Johnson, Jack Roush Jr., win at Lime Rock Park.
And the Roush boys do it. They cap off the front and the back.
Bookend the season, Dorsey. You talked about it. Great job by Jack Roush Jr. and Billy Johnson. And great performance by the Stephenson group there. They gave it everything. Look at this.
Now he's going to put on a show.
Now he's going to celebrate the 15th Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge win for Billy Johnson. It came down to the last lap of the last race of the season.
You got to trust the guy you're with. And look at that. They're bumping.
Spectacular Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge action from Lime Rock Park. We'll be back to hear from our winners. Another Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge season in the books and championships for Rumbum. They'll celebrate. Why would they not? They had a dominant season. But before we hear from our champions, let's hear from our race winner today. There with Darren Law.
Billy, great drive, buddy. Great drive. That's kind of the bookends for you guys. You won the first race of the year and the final race. Tell us about those last couple laps. I mean, you took it to the white flag, took them on the outside of one, and made it happen. That was a great drive.
Well, Matt did an awesome job. It was not easy, and it was great racing him. He raced me clean, and I was just at the right place at the right time. I was able to just hang on to the outside and rubbed a little bit, but came out on top. And just like you said, it's actually been a pretty miserable year. We had a lot of DNFs, a lot of mechanicals and stuff. That's definitely not the characteristic of Roush. But we won the first race, the last race, and it's actually a sad end of a four-year journey with me and Jack Jr. So it's great to win it on a good note with them.
That was great. And so what was the advantage? Did you have the grip level over and braking level? What got you there at the end?
Well, I think it was just the tires. Like, these Continental tires are amazing. And this car weighs more than a Sprint Cup car, and these tires are smaller. And to have the tires hold up to that kind of abuse, I think from our setup, I don't know if the nine car took tires, but we did on the last stop and conserved them and have a little bit more left than him. And that's what made the difference.
All right, great job, man. Congratulations. Over to Chris with the champions.
Woo. Darren, big celebration down over here at Rumbum. It was a year ago. Matt Blum thought he had won the championship. It was a mistake on some paperwork that took that championship away a couple hours later. Well, they get sweet redemption today. Great season by this team. Just consistency all year long. Matt, what a drive by you guys. Does this finally get you the redemption from last year?
Listen, we're focused on the fact that we won the back-to-back team championship. It's just a testament to this crew, this team, this owner. I mean, it's fantastic. I mean, to win the driver's championship is just icing on the cake. But, you know, thanks again. I mean, Continental Tire, we double stint those things. They were screaming at me, but they held on till the end and gave us a podium. I couldn't ask for a better season and a better group to share it with.
Nick, you've been chewing your fingernails down to nubs the past few weeks. This year, you get to share the championship with your co-driver.
Absolutely. With my co-driver and the entire team from Lou Bacardi, Joe Vardy, the entire Rumbum team. Obviously, you know, we say it over and over again, it is such a team sport. You know, we wind up on camera at the end of it, but it's every member of the team that makes this happen. The Continental Tires, the ST Shocks, everything together and managing that. We're super grateful to be here and that this worked out. And this guy, you know, Matt Plum is just a rock star. It's awesome.
Nick Longy, Matt Plum, your 2013 Grand Sport Champions.
Congratulations, and you could see and hear the emotion both for Matt Plum and certainly for Billy Johnson. And look at that, Matt Plum, Nick Longy, a dominant season. They take the championship by 32 points, but man, what a spectacular job by Matt Bell and John Edwards. Just two races is what really set them back there. Speaking of Matt Bell, John Edwards, let's go down to Darren Law.
Matt, that was a great run, man. Great fight all the way to the end. It was good to watch. What happened on the final lap?
You know what? I was playing defense a lot, as you would on the last few laps. Our car wasn't a second place car, honestly, but I was gonna give it at least everything I could. And I know the team put a lot of effort into it, kind of trying to do their homework. Didn't have a lot of time of practice this weekend, but you know, his car was so good. Billy's car was really great off turn seven. That's obviously the most important corner on the track, and I just didn't have it there. So our apex speed was down, sending off the old nine car right, and just excited to see what Chevy brings us next year.
You guys have had a great season. That was a great race. Chris?
Well, and TRG closes out the year with a good, strong finish. Top five, James Davison. You really had your hands full the middle part of this race. Tires just completely gone, but you still get a nice top five.
Yeah, we had a good run, and I'm very grateful to TRG for giving me this opportunity. I didn't know I was driving the car until yesterday morning, in fact. And my first time here ever at Lime Rock, one of the tracks I haven't driven. I didn't tell you that. it was very good fun. I really liked the track, and I'd like to do more races in the Conti series and certainly with TRG. So thanks a lot to them for the strategy, a great car, and hopefully we can do something together in 2014.
Yeah, Kevin Buckler and TRG setting up for a strong 2014.
Well, 2013 was awesome. I mean, you think about how the championship played out. Rumbum so strong. But, guys, when you look to the future, what are you seeing?
Well, I see a lot of great manufacturers involved in this championship, some brilliant teams. And when you look at the drivers out there today, boy, oh, boy, is there some talent throughout this field. Congratulations to the Rumbum team. They deserved it. 3 wins and 7 podiums with another one here today, Dawes.
I really like the fact that we've got some brand-new drivers coming in here with such talent, coming in from Europe, coming in from the United States, young guys that are going to carry this forward. And a great race rest then shown to the crowd for Ford and Chevrolet. Great job by all.
And the guys talk about teamwork. Well, hey, thanks to my team. Calvin Fish, Dorsey Schrader, Chris Neville, Darren Law, Bob Varsha, everybody else who helped us throughout the year. It's been a great season of Continental Tire Sports Car Challenge right here on Fox. We'll see you next year. So long, everyone.